I'm curious, you also talked about, you know, engaging the private side, businesses for shared prosperity. I wonder how gung-ho, how bullish are companies to share prosperity when, you know, there are just so many challenges facing their own survival, their own prosperity, considering so many uncertainties in the economy. 2023 was a year of inflation and high rates. What is your view for 2024? When you talk to your leaders, your members who are heads of companies, what do they tell you? Do they seem like they're more optimistic this year? Are they still worried? Are they, you know, excited to expand, or are they on wait and see?
Okay, I think everybody's view, well, most of the people's view is 2024 is going to be a more stable year than the previous year. So we're looking towards greater stability. Hopefully, inflation comes under control, thereby the pressure on wages and all the other concerns and margins will be addressed. We can exist better in that. We're looking forward to stable, a more stable economy, but we're also hoping for stability on the regulatory side or on the changes, because you know how it is. I mean, businesses get nervous when things are shifting. Uh-huh. So we're hoping for that as well. Now, competitiveness or businesses that are not or that are going through challenges. Yes, there are businesses that are definitely going through challenges. And that is precisely what we're trying to address when we say that some of the businesses really need to evolve. We need to be shifting as the world is shifting. Uh-huh. Need to address. Are we still going to see massive growth in the BPO industry? All the services that the service industries that we've been known for. So those are the things that we feel we should be going to. But on the issue of addressing the inclusivity or the shared prosperity, one of the things we have seen work is that when business is encouraged to invest into industries or services that address the pain point of the people, that in itself is already a major push towards shared prosperity. If we can make sure that commuting is not as difficult as it is, and that when people can be home earlier, or they can be healthier when they have more hours to rest and so forth, all of this add up to the shared prosperity factor already. Or when we can improve the services of some of the infrastructures that we have, all this will add to that idea of shared prosperity. So part of that is we're saying businesses should invest and address the pain points of the people, as we have done in the group, in the ALA group. The idea is we know health is a major issue, major concern. So we're saying, you know, everybody should try to chip in and okay. invest and put capital there so that health services in the country can work. A more effective and efficient health system will lower costs, so it will benefit those that are significantly disadvantaged at this time.
And we know that food security is also a problem, which is why your group, AC Logistics, you're planning to develop cold chain storage facilities across the country. Can you flesh out details of this plan, Renee? I mean, how big of an investment, over what time period, what can we expect from AC Logistics? Because I know that health and logistics are, you know, the two areas, the two units of Ayala Corporation that they're really trying to scale up. So what are we expecting from your end?
First of all, we are told, and I cannot be very sure of this number, but I'm told that the spoilage rate of fresh produce in the country is at about 40%. So 100 kilos of vegetable harvest eventually is only 60 kilos by the time it hits market, which is about probably the reason why our vegetables are more expensive than Singapore or London even. We know for a fact that some of our pork actually comes from Brazil. I've talked to the importers who bring it in. And the pork in Brazil is going at about 100, 110 pesos per kilo. And yet here it's 350. So that shows you that logistics plays a key role, not to mention the fact that we do import a lot of pork, chicken, and beef. So I think the opportunities there is if we can improve on logistics, then the spoilage rate goes down. If we can improve on efficiencies, then costs also go down. So we're not the only ones going into this area. There are many other companies looking at it. Last year, we did an experiment. We decided to backhaul using refrigerated trucks vegetables back into Metro Manila. And we peaked at about 2 tons of fresh produce a day. And yes, the spoilage rate did go down significantly, but we need to work on the models because it's not just providing trucks. It's not just making sure the schedule is followed. It's about harvesting schedules, market absorption capacity. We did an experiment, not an experiment. We opened a cold storage in Cagayan de Oro, a 5,000 pallet facility. Now I wish we did 10,000 because we're full. And the reasons why we decided to do Cagayan de Oro was we saw vegetables rotting on the core in the streets of, around the market. And we built a very modern blast freezing facility in our cold storage in Cagayan. Just really to enable people. I mean, there's a lot of produce coming from that northern Mindanao area that can be brought to Manila and to elsewhere. So the plan is, like everybody else, is to try to make logistics more efficient, more targeted, and effective so we can bring costs down.
All right. Rene, and where is the next cold storage facility that you're looking at? Is it going to be, you know, built from the ground up, or are you doing M&As for that?
We're doing an M&As. Proper disclosures will be made at the right time.
Okay.
But also building a few more facilities. Again, for regulatory and competitive reasons, we'd rather not say exactly where, but we will be building facilities, modern facilities. One of the challenges to cold storage for me is that there is new technology, there are new equipments that are more efficient. Your worry in cold storage is really kilowatt hour consumption per pallet. Some of the newer technologies allow us significant savings on kilowatt consumption per pallet. And if you save 10-20% on your kilowatt consumption per pallet in cold storage, that's already significant. That makes you a bit more competitive and also will benefit your customers.
All right. Exciting, exciting times ahead. We're just going to have to wait for the disclosures. But good to know there are more cold storage facilities in the pipeline. Rene, thank you so much for joining us. It was a pleasure and congratulations. We will be watching the exciting projects under your leadership from MAP. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much for the time.
All right.